Let's start recording.
Three in the morning, and I'm still awake. So I picked up a pen and a page, and I started writing just what I'd say if we were face to face. Tell you just what you mean to me. Tell you the simple truth. Be strong in the Lord and never give up hope. You're gonna do great things, I already know. God's got his hand on you, so don't live life in fear. Forgive and forget, but don't forget why you're here. Take your time.
Oh, ladies and gentlemen, gentlemen, gentlemen. Special guest. Hello, everybody, in the I Speak For You studios. But it is SanAntonioSports.com day here, as we've got the world famous Jay Tope. Hey, Jay, how are you doing?
I don't know about world famous or not, but I'm very happy to be here. And thanks so much for inviting me.
No, you know what? I was like, I've got to get Jay on here because high school rankings have come out.
Right.
A lot of football coming up.
Right.
I talked to Roosevelt coach the other day, Coach Carroll, the first. And I never knew this, but the first black coach in history of Northeast
of football. Yes,
yeah, I never knew that.
That's I mean, it almost seems unbelievable, but no, it's true. And so there you go. And but it's Roosevelt. They've got a guy that we're going to be featuring in our magazine in one of the little mini spotlights, named Arian Springs.
Oh, nice.
Defensive back. Roosevelt's going to be very, very good this year. Are they going to be able to get one of those playoff spots? I don't know, but they're definitely going to be in the running for it.
So we have so much to talk about. Obviously, you got the magazine here. We're going to talk about San Antonio Sports. We're going to talk about you, talk about OLU, all kinds of things going on. San Antonio Sports right there.
Yeah, SA Sports.
SA Sports. Sorry
because
about that.
San Antonio Sports gets upset.
A whole
upset.
Different world. Yeah, you don't want to talk about San Antonio Sports. Talk about SA Sports. Incredible. So let's talk about this real quick. Let's go back to Roosevelt. Because they had an incredible year last year. A lot of folks shocked a lot of folks, beat Churchill, beat Johnson,
right?
Beat some of the powerhouses. And then they came up against Steele. And of course, Steele, you know, it's
Steele. They're the powerhouse right now. Well, I say that, but I mean, you know, there's, you know, Judson will probably have one of their best teams they've had in years this year because they have so many young studs coming up. They're going to be incredible this year. You know, a lot of people have kind of, you know, said, oh, Judson, yeah, team of the past. I'm not a huge Judson fan per se. So, yeah, I went to home, so that's one of the reasons
why.
But that Judson team is going to be really good. You know, Brandeis has become a machine over on the north side. And you know, then you've got some of your 4A teams. That Harlandale team has the ability to go undefeated this season. They're going to be good. Brandon Ramon, remember that name, that quarterback?
Right.
Going to be good. East Central. Now, are they going to beat Steele? No. But they've got that 6'6" quarterback.
I couldn't imagine being that tall. 6'6".
Yeah, he's a senior quarterback, and they call him Too Long Jones, Jeremy Jones from East Central. And he's going to be a fun player to watch. He is already committed to Rice. And that Rice, yeah. When you commit to Rice, you know you've whether they're going to keep him as quarterback, I don't know, because when you're 6'6", boy,
and
offense coordinator wants you to be a receiver when you're 6'6".
I was about to say, when you're 6'6", and you're athletic as he is, a quarterback is really not in your future, so he's probably already learning wide receiver roots. I mean, he's got to do that anyway as a quarterback.
Right.
However, being 6'6", like you're right, defense or a tight end or a receiver.
Mm-hmm. And of course, you know, other teams to watch this year. Madison is going to be great.
Oh, yeah.
Madison's a reload school. Reagan will be good. You know, Churchill, you know, they're always good. You know, so it's going to be an exciting year. I was out there last night at Mata Stadium for you know, we had Midnight Madness. Memorial High School had,
oh, no way,
get this, they've got a second year coach. 2 years ago for their first practice, they had 14 kids.
Whoa.
Last year they had, in the 30s and 40s, there were 77 kids out there last night, and they've bulked up. They're not going to go 0-4 this year. You know, whether they're going to make the playoffs, I don't know, but because that's a pretty tough district. You know, Floresville is good, Harlandale, Medina Valley, Uvalde and stuff like that. But at Southside's got a very good team as well. But it was great to see 77 kids out there at midnight at Mata Stadium, because it's been years and years and years since they've had those kind of numbers in Memorial's football program. So
yeah, because Jay, you're not new to this. As folks that don't know, Jay Tope, obviously SA Sports, you've been on Ken's 5, you've been on all the TV stations and everything. You always bring the future superstars on the air and everything. But tell everybody a little bit about Jay Tope. Who are you? And because you've been doing this for as long as I can remember.
Right. Well, I'm a criminal. I've been, I was in radio before I was actually into high school sport. You know, I played some high school sports, but I was mainly a band geek. That was me.
And what instrument did you play?
I played tuba. And 1 year I played marching bass guitar, you know, and that was a lot of fun. Marched in the Rose Bowl parade when I was in, I only went my first 2 years to Holmes High School. Then I moved to Tucson, went to Palo Verde High School there, and we were one of 9 bands selected for the 82 Rose Bowl parade.
Nice.
And so that was very cool. And being a Churchill grad, you know, Churchill's had some experience with the Rose Bowl parade.
I had to sell a lot of taffy candy to get over there, yeah.
But it's an amazing experience. And so, but, you know, and sometimes you feel as a high school student that, you guys aren't getting the publicity, whether it's band or sometimes in some cases volleyball, football.
Right.
So that was one of the things, that I always thought, wonder if there's a way where the high school kids can get, better publicity. So I started, in addition to my radio career, working with Sonny Melendres and people like that. Great, great people. I've been really blessed with having great people, mentor me. And I was, while I was at KTSA, KTFM, I had started working with a website called, this is back in 99, 2000, called schoolsports.com out of Boston, Massachusetts. And they were trying to branch out into, more communities nationwide. San Antonio was one of those communities.
Right.
So they had me write for them. And you're a runner. And you do a lot of, running.
A lot of races, yeah.
Yes. I mean, you are the race announce god for South Texas.
Well, I appreciate
farther.
That. But you and I both don't know. I know you do the American Heroes Relay and all that fun stuff down at the Alamo Stadium. And
oh, yeah.
We both are in the same thing. We know so many of the same people and everything. And I've worked for you at Radio San Antonio and all that. But it's one of those things is when you have a kinship and you have a friendship, you always help out those, and you're like, hey, let's get Jay on the air because you do so much for the kids in San Antonio. Like you said, you want to promote them. You want to publicize the great deeds that they're doing because these are not just athletes. They're not just band geeks, as we say. I was a drummer in band, but their academics is up there as well. They just can't, you just can't be like, oh, you're a great football player, because nowadays in Texas especially, you have to have the grades in order to play.
Well, and there's so many stories that need to be told. I mean, some of these athletes have just overcome amazing obstacles in their life to be able to do what they're going to do.
Right.
And they're doing it for the love of the game. You know, it's not like in college or pro. It's a different animal altogether. But when you're doing it for the love of the game, it makes it so much more enjoyable. And again, there's great stories to tell. I was mentioning that I had started out with schoolsports.com, and ESPN started covering some of my stories, which was very cool. And what happened was I was at a cross-country meet back when they used to have them at UTSA. And it was one of those, it was with regional meet at UTSA, 45 degrees, raining, and all that stuff. And if you've been to high school cross-country meets, for some reason they think it's hilarious to put bales of hay right before the finish line.
I don't understand that.
Let them run the race, but, meanwhile they got to hurdle these, There was a girl from Fredericksburg. Fredericksburg used to be one of the powerhouses in running, and they're still not bad. There was a girl named Misty Korzik that was the number one 4A runner in the state. And she's, there's nobody anywhere near her as she's coming around the
right,
bend.
Right.
People, and at these regional meets, thousands of people are there. Before she gets to the first bale of hay, she just collapses. They didn't know it at the time, but she had anemia. Her coach goes running to her. The UIL official informs the coach, hey, if you touch her, she's disqualified. He says, I don't give a crap.
Right.
Give me an ambulance or something. And she sticks her face out of the mud, says, don't touch me, coach. crawls to the finish line with everybody screaming. I mean, and the thing was that she didn't finish first. She finished 17th. But because she finished 17th, they qualified for the state, you know, cross country.
Right.
I mean, there weren't a lot of dry eyes there, okay? Nothing covered by the Express and News, okay? And so that happening, and then a few months later, there was an athlete named Tony Limon, played for South San High School. Everybody will remember him as the one that threw the elbow, knocking the East Central guy into Kingdom Come.
Right.
And because he was on probation at the time, he was sentenced to 5 years of prison. Everybody says, you know, how can you sentence somebody to prison for something that happens on a basketball court? It's because he violated his terms of probation.
Right.
Because they considered it an assault, because he went after the guy. I know this guy now. He's a really good guy. You know, everybody makes mistakes.
Yeah.
But the fact that this thing was covered front page, first story on the news and everything, I said, man, there's so many good things going on, and this is front page. So that's when I said, you know what, I'm going to start up my own high school sports website. And that was in 2001, and this is our 13th season.
That's amazing. Because you've covered, I mean, obviously Olympians and everything, like Jimmy from Churchill, you know, great swimmer, obviously Olympian, medalist at Olympics, not just pack fodder, as I like to call folks.
Destiny Hooker, you know.
Destiny Hooker, another one, yeah.
She's still doing great stuff.
Oh, my goodness.
And you know, she's just one of those people. Megan Simmons might be the greatest girls basketball player that ever played here in San Antonio. You know, she holds the record, but the reason that she was loved so much, not just by fans and athletes, is because off the court, she had one of the neatest demeanors ever. I mean, she's just on the court, man, she's nasty.
Right.
But, you know, there's a reason why Pat Summitt picked her out and said, you're coming to Tennessee and you're going to start your freshman year. How many people get a chance to do that?
Not many. I would not try to guard her in the paint at all. But you've seen, I mean, like I said, for 13 years you've done this, but, and we always talk about this, how varsity volleyball players, baseball, whatever, you hear at San Antonio high schools, a lot of them have been playing together for years. Mm-hmm. Club ball, you know, community ball, whatever, because when they get to that varsity level, you just can't walk on. You've got to be extreme talented. And my question to you is how much have you seen the transgression from, I would say, from 13 years ago to today with the high school athlete?
Well, I think that more people on more sides of town are getting involved in off-season sports. It used to be primarily, you know, something like, for instance, some of the volleyball clubs, I mean, it's like $5,000 a year.
Oh, it's no joke.
To play that. The reason is because some of these tournaments that they go to, you know, these national tournaments, it just costs a lot of money to do that. They do that so you don't have to do any more fundraising. But with the advent of DFY, you know, Dreams for Youth, that there's some leagues that the coaches at Harlandale, Sylvia Cardenas, has helped form. To where, you know, the girls at those schools, at the Southside schools, at the inner city schools can play, and it doesn't cost as much. And they have, you know, some scholarships, you know, to where, you know, I mean, if the kid has no money, there's no reason why they can't be playing some club sports that'll help them out. And I think that's really been the big thing. I mean, so many more girls and boys, for that matter, are playing club sports off season. There's good to this and bad to this. Good thing is, and not just the club sports, but the advent of social media. It used to be like, and I'll give you an example, Clark and O'Connor, you know, even in volleyball, you know, at the end of a game, you know, they get the girls to shake hands and get people out of there so they didn't get in a fight, because that's their enemy school. Well, most of those girls are playing with other girls on the club. So usually what happens is after they do the shaking of hands, everybody's hugging everybody.
Right.
You see that in basketball a lot and so many other sports because, you know, yes, they're playing for their high schools, but these kids know each other now so much more because of club ball, one, and because of social media, too. That has changed a lot. So you don't have as many, you know, situations as, you know, like back when we were going to school. And people would burn, you know, letters on the football fields. Plus, people don't do that as much just because it's, you know, $500,000 artificial turf and you go to prison for it. It's not like you're burning a spot in grass. You don't see a lot of that as much, you know. Yes, there's rivalries, but there's not as much of the hate as there was.
Yeah, because I know, I mean, a mutual friend of ours, John Kimmel, and they put on the AOA Sports. They have huge volleyball tournaments. I mean, teams from all over the state come to them. And it's one of those things, like a friend of mine, his daughter plays club ball. She's not even in high school yet, but she's playing with high school girls. And she already knows what high school she's going to. I mean, obviously, we know that there's people that move into certain school districts or areas because they want their son to play at Johnson. They want their daughter to play at Reagan volleyball. You know, it's huge.
I've had so many people call me or email me and say, hey, we're planning on moving to San Antonio. My daughter's playing volleyball. Where should I move? And it puts me in a bad situation because I'm completely, you know, unbiased.
That you know every coach in San Antonio.
Yes, and so I mean, you know, I'll send them a link to the standings for the volleyball teams.
Right.
But I you know, the thing is that sometimes they're disappointed because sometimes they'll go to a school and if it's a powerhouse like say a Reagan or a Johnson or an O'Connor, then they're, you know, chances are maybe their daughter's not going to get a chance to play. Sometimes I would kind of rather see them play at a school where they're going to get a chance to play.
Right.
You know, that's competitive, but again, you know, and they can completely, you know, help if it's a really good volleyball player, they can completely, you know, turn a school around. Johnson's a pretty good example of that. A couple of years ago, they had a great volleyball player and they went to state for the first time ever. Somebody like that can completely turn a team around. Reagan is just a reload factory. You know, you look at some of those girls that are in fifth grade, you know, they could probably play varsity volleyball in some of the places. I mean, they're you know, who knew the fourth and fifth grade girls would be doing overhand serves and jump serves and all this.
Oh, it's amazing.
Stuff.
It's amazing. We're going to take a real quick commercial break. This is going to be Chris Tomlin, our guy. Jay Tope, thanks for coming in. We're going to be right back, ladies and gentlemen. If you have any questions, you can text us at 210-374-0140. That's not a call number. It is a text number. And we'll be right back with more SA Sports.
Greater.
Oh my goodness, I love J Tope. Love it. You can't hear what we're talking about, but because that's why we turn the mics off, so you really can't hear the stuff that we talk about. But again, folks, you listen, I Speak For You in as ispeakforyou.net. But obviously it's sasports.com is what you want to go to. And if you want to advertise in it, you've got some incredible advertising rates. I've been talking about the folks on air, I've been talking about it folks at races, because and I don't even tell them about the half price deal, the meal deal you're doing right now.
Oh,
but
yeah.
The magazine goes out to everywhere. I mean, it's huge.
It's 20,000 copies we put out. We put it out on a quarterly basis. And what we do is we cover, and we don't cover college, or it's all high school athletes. You know, there's a, you know, from Somerset, and it's all around. We don't just do San Antonio schools, but we go to like out to Del Rio, Brackettville, up to Blanco, Eagle Pass.
Oh yeah.
And it's a lot of fun what we do. And what I'm excited about is you know, the website, you know, and this, and we've got some combo packages that are just, you know, everybody said, you know, that you can't be possibly be, you know, charging that. I said, yes, I can. Printing's expensive, so I mean, we do have to make some money.
Right, right.
But it's 20,000 copies, and a lot of those go out to the high school booster clubs themselves.
Right.
When I say we deliver them to the high school booster clubs, we don't send a box. We actually hand deliver them out of the box because they get passed out that way. If you have
awesome.
A box, they're going to end up as a you know, a door holder, you know, in the weight room or something like that.
Right.
And the other way we give them out is at our various tour stops when we go out to the high schools and stuff like that. Our target audience is parents. That's the other thing people think, high school sports. It says, well, kids aren't really our target audience. I'm like, well, that's great, because it's not our target audience either.
Right.
Kids love what we do, and they'll definitely read, or they'll go to the website. But that's not our parents are our target audience. And if you've ever been, and you've been associated with booster clubs for a long time, a lot of those people are small business owners, you know, so if that's your audience, you know, that's a great audience to have. And our website, if you go to the website, if you go to the Churchill page on sasports.com, you'll see that we've got the football and volleyball schedules up for almost every one of our 120 high schools in the area. So it's a great resource.
It's incredible, because you're talking about schedules and everything, and I do the Twitter for Roosevelt. I'm a Churchill grad. My best friend, holy man, I just lost his name. Holy smokes.
Oh, no.
I don't remember that one.
Yeah.
Todd Bloomer, he's an assistant principal at Churchill. He runs a Churchill Twitter. So when I was going over to Churchill, and of course my wife was the lead counselor over there, he was like, oh, this is how you do it. And he was teaching me all this stuff. And I was like, oh, okay. And like you, it's a learn by fire. I mean,
yes.
You're like, oh, oops, I can't put that. You know, oh,
yeah.
I can't put a picture of a child unless I get the approval, you know,
right.
That kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So when she transferred over to Roosevelt, they didn't have any of that. There was no social media at all. So I was like, well, I'm going to start a Twitter. So I started a Twitter for Roosevelt. I do the band stuff. You know, I put things in there. And one thing I was telling about, and I did it today, is I put on Roosevelt's things. Like, hey, we're going to talk about Roosevelt and Churchill and among all their schools for SA Sports here on the air. And they started retweeting it and all this stuff. But I know they're, like you said, camps are starting today. Football starts today. Volleyball starts today. A lot of the bands are in the thing. And cheerleaders are already doing their thing.
Right.
Cheerleading is a sport, folks. I know some folks are like,
yes, it is.
Some folks are like, oh, no, that's not a sport.
Yeah,
cheerleaders by definition, and you know, I mean, you can correct me. I asked you, would you? Cheerleaders get hurt more than football players do.
Oh yeah. No, it's although I did see last night at Midnight Madness, a kid break his wrist.
No.
And I mean, he was doing those back pedals, you know.
Yeah,
he broke his wrist. He was a freshman, so I mean, you know, it's not like a senior breaks his wrist and ruins his senior year. Cheerleading, and you need to go to one of these cheerleading contests that they sometimes will have, like at the Lilac Hawker Theater or something like that. There's a reason why cheerleaders, and people might not know this, cheerleaders get scholarships. We had a student writer from Medina Valley that got a cheerleading scholarship to San Angelo up there, State. And there's a reason why they get scholarships, because I mean, it does take athletic ability to it's nice if you're the cheerleader, the one that's being carried, and you know,
the one in the basket.
Yes, but you know, there's people throwing those people around in the air, and
it's hard.
Try that with your sisters. No, don't try that with your kids. Don't try that at home.
Right, exactly.
It's great. They like the fact that we cover them. The band, you know, those band parent booster clubs
Holy
are usually
smokes.
bigger than the athletic booster clubs. And all you have to do, and we've had great relationships with the band. You know, I've emceed the spaghetti dinner over Churchill High School sometimes because of the fact that nobody gives them any coverage. I'm like, fine, we'll do it. You know, because band might not be a sport, but there is a competitive nature to band. And all you have to do is go to some of these, you know, Drums Along the Medina, which is one of my favorites. Harlandale has a great band fest. Then the district ones that go on with Northeast, Northside, and SAISD. By the way, if you haven't been to Wheatley Heights, that is a pretty darn cool stadium.
Really?
And so that's, since Alamo Stadium's being renovated, that's where SAISD's doing the games that would normally
be. I did not know that.
Wheatley Heights facility is a really nice stadium. I mean, hopefully they keep using it. If you hadn't had a chance to go out there, that's where they had the American Hero run this
year. Right.
Oh, my God. I was just like, what? This is like a jewel that nobody knows about. You know, and I think it was part of that city bond money that helped fund it. Great, great facility. And looking forward to watching some games. And I'm sure that SAISD will probably use that instead of Spring Sports Complex for their marching competition. And
yeah, because Battle of Bands, obviously for Fiesta, the Battle of Flowers Festival, we did it at we did it at Blossom at Comalander Stadium this year, and it was packed. You talk about the band boosters. I remember last year Roosevelt and Johnson were playing. Both bands were at UIL, so only half the stands were full because the bands are gone, which takes up a whole section.
Yeah.
I mean, you know this.
Yes.
And then the other section is taken up by the parents. I mean, you know, it's huge.
Yes.
And they say, well, the bands are gone. It's like, okay, everybody's here for the football game, but it's really the bands that draws a lot of folks.
Well, you figure there's probably about, you know, anywhere from 50 to 100 football players out there, and, you know, they have their parents. Well, those band parents are showing up, and those bands are usually about twice that size at least.
Oh, yeah, because, let's see, I think the largest band in Northeast is Johnson, and then Roosevelt comes in second, and then Churchill. But I know that Churchill, problem with the bands, and I know we're talking about SA Sports and everything, because but the bands are there to support the sports. I know they go to the basketball games, volleyball games, stuff like that, in a smaller scale. They don't have the whole marching band out there, per
se. Pep rallies.
Rallies, huge, because the pep rally can't start until the drum line comes in. I'm sorry, I was a percussionist. I was a snare guy. Uh-huh. But it's one of those things where they're being farmed into, same as athletics, same as football and volleyball and everything, and basketball, baseball certainly, is those band members are being farmed into who's got the best band at high school. Mm-hmm. Because from there, they go on to drum corps, which Crossman do a show every Thursday. And I'm on the board of directors for the Crossman Drum Corps. But they get farmed into those. And then they go from there, and they're all music teachers. They're all educators.
Right.
So band, I mean, you coming from tuba, me coming from snare, it affects your life. I mean, it's one of those things that you cannot go through. And I'll challenge the folks who are listening and everything. But this is taped, by the way, so they can go back and listen to it later. I challenge the folks to go through a day, just 24 hours. Matter of fact, let's scratch that. 12 hours, and you'll hear music somewhere.
Yeah. Oh, definitely.
There's no way you can go without music.
No. And it'll be, you know, here's the thing. You know, we were talking about some of the local 5A bands and the 4A bands. Then you get out to some of these little communities, like, for instance, Nueces Canyon High School.
Yep.
Out there at Camp Wood and Barksdale. It's a 1A school. But every single time that it's their turn, you know, because it alternates with UIL. Yeah, 5A, 3A state competitions one year, 4A, 2A, 1A the other year. Every single year they're top 10. How is that? And it's not like a rich school,
right?
But they have such a great tradition with their band. Pearsall, Crystal City, some Harper is another one. Those schools are incredible with their bands, and with usually not a lot of money, but they just, you know, and how tough is it to put together a marching band from a school that only has 86 people in it? Nueces Canyon has 86 students in there. I would guesstimate about 35 of those are in the marching bands. And it's always cool when you go to the smaller schools, because at halftime, it's either the drum major or you know, five of the people will be out there with their football uniforms.
I was about to say that, because I know Roosevelt and Churchill as well. There's some of those folks that are cheerleaders or ROTC, which is totally a different, incredible organization. My hat's off to ROTC folks. But they literally, they're doing their thing, and then at halftime, they're in the band, you know, like you were saying. So it's one of those things where they're pulling double hat. They don't get the rest during halftime. They're performing, then they go back third quarter, do what they usually do. But it's one thing, hats off to the kids, because and I remember marching in high school, and the football players would come out, and one of our snare drummers was a football player. Uh-huh. So he'd take his helmet off. He'd have his pads out there. He'd be playing with us. And it was one of those things is we watched sideline to sideline. We didn't go diagonal, back up, all that stuff. Mm-hmm. Like today, I call them musical athletes, because they really got to be in shape in order to play.
Yes, they do. They that's what band camp's all about, is getting you in shape.
If you're not in shape, they know. Because I know, I mean, I gotta cut you off, but I know Churchill, they do they were doing boot camp. They were literally having boot camps out there, and they were running them, doing calisthenics, burpees, all that stuff. And I'm going, oh, I'm so glad I'm not in high school band anymore.
Band, yeah. I mean, because they get you in shape, because especially, you know, like, for instance, you know, you're carrying a tuba, carrying a snare drum, you know, the, you know, I don't know how any of the bass drum players even have backs that are, you know, the shape they're supposed to be in, because I mean, that, you know, it's a tough job. And you know, they definitely don't get the credit for it, but you know, one of the ways we give them credit, in addition to, you know, doing some articles on them, is of course with our photography staff, Tony Murano.
I was about to talk about that, because I looked through the magazine and everything, and you have some incredible photos in here.
Well, and like I said, I mean, even on the website today, we've got photos from last night's Midnight Madness. If you go to sasports.com, you'll see the link that there. Tony Murano, who's one of the best of photographers anywhere. I mean, he does photographers for the, you know, for the Spurs, Silver Stars, Scorpions, and everything. We're blessed to have him as our senior photographer. We got a team of six this year, photographers, so I'm really excited about that aspect. But yeah, so I mean, you know, when they're taking football pictures, for instance, they're not just taking pictures of the football teams, but you know, they'll have some shots of the stands, shots of the band. Somebody asked me one time, says, yeah, but you know, you take pictures of all of those people, don't you have to get releases and all that stuff? I said, you know what, we've been doing this for 13 years. You know how many people have said,
hey, wait a minute,
yeah, could you please not give our daughter or son publicity? Zero. Okay?
Exactly.
You know, and that's, you know, like I said, you know, and if somebody for some reason says, I don't want my son's picture or daughter's, we'll be more than happy to take that down and put somebody else and give them the publicity. But we've never had that. Most of the time, it's usually, how come you didn't put my daughter or son's picture on there?
Yeah, so. I was videotaping the drum line at Roosevelt last year, and traditionally on a third quarter, they don't go up in the stands with the band. They sit there on the sidelines and just jam out. And I was videotaping them, and a parent comes up and he goes, what are you doing? So I'm videotaping a drum line. Okay, well, make sure you get my son. He's a third snare right there.
Yeah.
And then my daughter's on the cymbals. Make sure you get her. And I'm like, oh, okay, sure. But we're talking about SA Sports. You've done this magazine. It's credible. Who's on the cover of the issue this year?
I cannot tell you who's on the cover. All I will tell you is, because it comes out September 16th, and by the way, deadline for advertising is August 16th, it's a cross-country runner, which has never been featured on a
– From which school?
That'll give it up. It's a cross country runner. I will tell you that their colors are blue and white, and that's as far as I can go on there. But it's a cross country runner.
So right now everybody's going blue and white.
Yeah, exactly. And there's a lot of blue and white schools.
Right.
I will also tell you that it's outside the city limits. So it's not Somerset.
Right.
So there you go. That narrows it down a little more. And it's off 87.
Stop Rigsby. We're not gonna talk about it. So let's I'm gonna put you on the spot real quick, because you're a dear friend of mine. Let's go through the sports. Who is the football player to watch this year?
Wow.
We already talked about the 6'6 guy.
Yeah. You know,
Who's gonna be on the ESPN rankings?
Probably, gosh, you know how you forgot your best friend's name, so it's okay for me to forget somebody's name. There's a running back for Steele, and it's not. I can't remember right off the bat. But anyway, he was the one, and he's been playing since his freshman year. You remember the year that Malcolm Brown got hurt?
Oh, yeah.
That one backup who is now their big stud
guy.
Runner.
Yeah.
He's going to be the guy that everybody's going to be going. That's the guy to watch. That's, you know, that's going to be, you know, one of the guys that could be the Johnny Manziel. I really think, you know, like I said, if Harlandale does manage to go undefeated, you know, they're not going to have the most difficult schedule in the world. They do have Floresville. Floresville is going to be good.
Very
Medina
tough.
Valley, Southside. But with their non-district schedule, if they end up going 10-0, you're going to hear a lot of people singing Brandon Ramon's praises. He's a junior. He's a quarterback. He's got so much upside to him. So he's going to be one. You know, and it wasn't that long ago, back in 2001, when they had a quarterback, Tope Carotti, that was one of the best quarterbacks that ever played in San Antonio. If he hadn't have fallen asleep in an Arizona Cardinals camp, he might have been still playing pro football. But it's
yeah, I don't think you should do that.
No, that and God bless Tope Carotti. I love him to death. I mean, nobody knows what he went through. Right. That story should be a ESPN
whole different
movie.
That's right.
Week.
That's right.
But you have so many great athletes. You know, there's some. I'm looking forward. You know, as a Husky fan, and I saw Dave Campbell's Texas Football ranking Huskies last in Northside, but I think that's a big mistake because they not only have they been fifth and sixth in the past 2 years in that district. You know, close to a playoff spot. They were 2 points away last year from a playoff spot. They have a new coach with Eddie Salas, who right. comes from Bernie's Champion. Guy knows a little bit about football, and I just can't see them finishing in last in that district. Yes, they've got some good teams. Marshall, they just barely made the playoffs last year. They have a new coach, and they have some people coming up that apparently are the real deal. So they're. I mean, that's a tough district. Is Brandeis a bad team? No, they're going to be one of the. O'Connor went to the state semifinals last year for the first time ever. Can't count out Clark. Jay is always surprised. They've got a new coach.
I just had to put that. You talked about Clark. Gucci Bowl is coming up August 29th, and that typically is the first game that kicks off the high school season here. But there's other games that night. I mean, they packed it on Thursday night.
Holy Bowls that night.
Yeah.
Holy Cross Central Catholic. Speaking of the private schools, Antonian is going to be really, really good this year. Central Catholic, they've got the Coach Bird from Alamo Heights there now. And it's speaking of, coaches that have come in, Antonian, they have Van Fushak, who used to be at MacArthur for years. So you got a lot of those guys. San Antonio Christian school sometimes, that gets left out. They're always a very competitive force.
Yeah, a lot of folks didn't know that David Robinson, obviously the admiral from the Spurs, his son played football for Sacks.
Yes, and is now at Notre Dame.
Now at Notre Dame. Sacks is one of those schools, and we've got a 4-year-old. She's going to start going there here in 3 weeks as a pre-K. But Sacks, they don't know it. I mean, it's obviously a private school, as everybody else is, Tony and all those.
Yeah.
So their funding doesn't come from state.
Right.
All their stuff's in-house, tuitions, boosters, stuff like that. So when you get those caliber athletes, and there's been a lot of NFL players and everything, you come from private schools, but it's one of those folks that a lot of folks won't hear about them until signing day, and they're like, oh, wow, he's going to Notre Dame? I didn't know he was playing here.
Yeah, and you get on some of those campuses, two other schools that have reestablished football programs after many years, St. Mary's Hall, and
beautiful, beautiful facility.
All that brand new facility is incredible. They have a run called the Midnight Deuce every year that I emcee. And also, in addition to that, Castle Hills, they had pretty much left their athletic program for dead. In the last couple of years, it's been built back up. It's pretty exciting for some of these high schools. Feast, people forget about them. Family Educators Alliance at South Texas, which is the homeschool. They actually, the homeschool kids have their own league and everything.
Yeah, they've got a cross country. I mean,
their cross country runners have been, those Dunn girls have been some of the best cross country runners.
Oh, yeah.
Out of anybody, regardless of, and their basketball teams are competitive. You know, they play teams like Taft and stuff like that. They're very good. So there's a lot of great things going on. Antonian, speaking of Antonian, Devlin Lovell, who's one of the best cross country coaches around. He gets about half those kids at Antonian to run cross country.
Right.
And Antonian doesn't hold a second candle at anybody in cross country.
And that includes O'Connor, who has Randy Raina, one of the greatest distance runners in San Antonio, went to Arkansas, All American. His brother Ruben Rio's over there, I think.
Yeah.
Has been there. But Randy Raina coaching O'Connor, and you have Jimmy Dykes coaching Sacks. There are some incredible cross-country teams that are going to be like, and they're running. I mean, I've seen them. I've seen Sacks over here on the hills doing repeats and everything. I'm going, man, these guys are crazy. Mm-hmm. But y'all, you know, we talk about the fitness and everything of band members, and we have fitness, obviously, of our athletes. There's a lot of folks, like I said, there is no off season. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of football players that have been in the gyms all summer.
Right.
You know, a lot of folks getting in shape, getting ready for the season, because the seniors know this is it. This is their calling card for the next level.
Yeah, and we're talking about cross country. Like I said, that's why I thought it'd be kind of cool to have somebody, you know, and I will tell you that it's a female cross country runner. And another hint will be that she's a junior. She's been at state both her freshman and sophomore year in cross country and track.
Okay, blue and white uniform.
Yeah.
Off of 87. And junior.
Yes.
She's been to state. Okay.
Yeah, okay. Wow. That narrows it down a little bit. And here's the final hint. Her dad's been coaching cross country at the same school for 31 years.
Oh, yeah. Okay. I know who that is. Okay. I can't say who it is, of course. But yeah, we've got incredible runners like at O'Connor, Liza Hunter-Galvine, two-time Olympian, UTSA standout, graduate. Her daughter goes to O'Connor, and she just ran, I think, a 5:03 mile. So she's coming down, and then you watch college track field or track and field meets, and the girls are running 4:40, 4:45, and I'm going, these are high school athletes. I mean, you and I've been around when the Reinas were running track and they were lapping people in the 1 mile. So
I went to middle school with Janice.
Yeah. So
and she was a, you know, dang good runner as well. But she went to Jay, you know,
right.
We both went to Pease, and then she went to Jay. I went to Holmes because Pease fed into three different middle schools
at the
time. And yeah, good family too.
Incredible family. But SA Sports, you find the magazine, sasports.com is the website. If you want to advertise, the rates are so ridiculously low that you've got to do it now. You've got to do it now because let's talk about the rates real quick, Jay, because it pretty much goes all into production because it costs a lot to do magazines.
Yeah, this isn't free. And a lot of people have said, right, well, why don't you do this online just to have an online? Well, then it's a website. I mean, people, the parents especially, want this tangible thing in their hands.
Right.
This is one of these things, especially when people have advertised and they've said, hey, can we put a coupon? I said, it'll never get used. Because people don't want to cut this up.
They won't cut it up. Yeah.
This is going to stay in the house. You know, newspapers get thrown out.
Right.
Magazines will end up staying in the household for a long time. I mean, you know, I tell you, you know, on my coffee table, for instance, you know, there's probably seven or eight different, whether it's a men's health magazine or a home and garden magazine or whatever, but these stick around the house.
Right.
So you know, people are going to be constantly using this. And it's one of the other things about it is the price right now is very incredible, because when I tell everybody that they can get into the magazine a quarter page for $350 and it's going out to 20,000, you know, I mean, people, that's pretty darn cheap for magazine. You try doing that with another magazine, it's
now,
not gonna happen.
I worked at Texas Trophy Hunters for a while, and let's see, that would be probably a $1,200 ad at Texas Trophy Hunters.
Right. And again, for that targeted audience, even a full page, you can get a full page for $9.50. Okay. I mean, a full page in this magazine. And what we can do, especially, for instance, we've got two big articles on people from Wilson County. One, of course, being the cross country runner that's on the front page.
And that was another hint, folks, by the way.
Yes, Wilson County. There you go. And of course, we couldn't have this magazine without doing a little story on Poth volleyball. Poth volleyball, Coach Zenner, she is one of the best volleyball coaches ever. And here's why. Everybody figures, well, yeah, but those Poth girls are tall. Tall doesn't take you to state.
Doesn't mean talent.
Yeah. Doesn't take you to state at 8 out of 10 years and winning about half of those. Poth is the recognized leader in volleyball in the state of Texas for 2A. There's a reason why they go to tournaments where all the 5A teams are playing, because there's no competition.
Well, not that, but you're right. But that's one of those schools that the parents are going, and they're like I said, they're emailing you, they're getting a hold of you, but they're following the track records of schools for the last 10 years going, okay, Poth, that's the volleyball I want to send my daughter to, or Reagan, or, you know.
But you know what? They haven't had hardly any move-ins, and they haven't been affected by Eagle Ford Shale, which is another thing we're going to talk about in the magazine. Eagle Ford Shale, some of those schools, you know, down the line, like closer to Three Rivers, the Carrizo Springs and stuff like that, are really having their numbers jump. Three Rivers could go from 1A to 3A this next go-round in UIL. That's how much growth has been around.
Wow.
Lavernia is a 3A school. They will probably be 4A this next go-round, because everybody wants to move out of those areas. But Poth hasn't had a lot of that move in. So you got a lot of people like Shelby Anta, their parents went to Poth and everything like that. But Coach Zenner, and this is one of her smaller teams that she's had, but they were at the state tournament last year. They lost one girl. They've got everybody coming back, and they've only got two seniors on this squad. They're gonna be, but this is one of the shorter teams they've had. Okay, so they don't have anybody over 5'8". They've had some 6'2" girls,
right?
There. Okay, so it's a mark of a great coach that no matter who she's got, they're gonna be pretty stout.
Right, right. You don't need to be 6'2" because they're gonna have a dominant team.
Because defensively, they're not gonna let a ball touch the court.
Right.
And that's the other thing about our magazine. We have never had a football player on the front cover of our magazine. Irritates some football purists. But
I was about to say, football is Texas pretty much to a lot of folks.
Right, but if we put a football player on our magazine, then we're all of a sudden like a whole bunch of other magazines, and we always want to keep ourselves. We've had a girls basketball player, we've had a volleyball player, Dominic Gonzalez, which, by the way, how they have the Sports Illustrated jinx?
Right.
No. She just got done playing 4 years over at SAGU. Had an incredible college career at SAGU. Dominic Gonzalez, volleyball.
Right.
She ended up at Penn State, national champion, caliber team. And I have a feeling great things will happen for the girl that's going to be on our front cover of this magazine.
Man, you're not going to give that away at all. You're not going to give it away at all.
SASports.com,
folks. You got to go check it out. We're going to take a quick commercial break, and then we're going to come back, and I'm really going to pick Jay's brain about high school sports here in San Antonio. We'll be right back.
Ship would leave the country, but I'd rather swim ashore. Without a life, this I'd be stuck again. Wish I was much more masculine. Maybe then I could learn to swim like 18 miles away. Now floating up and down, I spin colliding into sound. Like whales beneath me diving down, I'm sinking to the bottom of my everything that freaks me out. The lighthouse gleam has just run out. I'm cold as cold can be.
To the ocean. thought of just your face.
We're on.
And so.
Yeah. Again, folks, there's conversations that we have that cannot be broadcast. But no, we're talking about what we're talking about, and I'll let you in on it. But what we're talking about is music at high school athletic events. Like, yes. what can be played, what can't be played. A lot of the kids, yes, they listen to Lady Gaga, or they listen to whoever, Young Jeezy or whatever they are. But you can't play those at a school-sanctioned event. You can play what you want in your car. However, when it comes to those events, there's only a certain songs that you can play.
Right, and sometimes you'll get, you know, people that will, you know, I mean, you know, coaches that'll say, hey, man, you know, here's our warm-up CD. And I'm saying, really? Here it is back.
Right. Oh, that looks nice. That's a nice CD. Here you go.
We do 140 events at the schools, between 140 and 150 each school year. And so, I mean, it's imperative that we keep it clean. And we do, and but yeah, we'll sometimes butt heads with more with the players. You know, the students will be a little upset. I love them to death. We'll promote them to death, but I really don't care what they think about our music because they're there, one, to play ball.
Right.
Some of them get so hyped up with the music, you know, and a lot of times you'll see people warming up and they got those Dr. Beat headphones and stuff like that.
They have their own stuff going on.
Yeah. But, you know. The announcing and all that stuff is for the kids. The music's for the parents.
Right.
Because the parents are the ones that are going to say, hey, yeah, we want you back.
Right.
So you don't want to tick them off. And as I was saying earlier, off the air, I had a situation at Comfort where, you know, they wanted me to play their warm-up CD. And I made the mistake of doing it. And, it wasn't pretty. And they weren't thinking, you know, that Comfort coach, I can't believe they use that for their warm-up CD. They were thinking, hey, Big City SASports.com comes in here and thinks they can play that garbage in our gym. And it took a while before we could do another event at Comfort because, I mean, we have school board members and all that, especially in those small towns.
Yeah, and you do pep rallies as well as I do, and it's one of those things like, okay, like when I do Churchill's pep rallies, obviously Meet the Chargers is coming up. I'm sitting here going, okay, my song selection can be this, you know, okay, my song selection when I do Red, White, and Blue Review at Roosevelt can be this,
right? Yeah,
it's two different. It's, yeah,
it is different, and volleyball and basketball are two different. You know,
it's huge. Yeah,
yeah, it's and. I mean, you think about what I can play at a volleyball game. Yeah, I can play some R&B, but I mean, it's, you know, there's some rock involved stuff like that. Basketball is definitely a little more R&B oriented, and there will be some rap songs, but it's all clean stuff. And when I say clean stuff, just because they bleep out words doesn't make it clean.
No.
You know, it's got to be, you know, a clean version where nobody's, you know, you can't even give them the think of, hey, did something just happen that shouldn't have?
Right.
Okay. And baseball, softball is another completely different
thing. World.
Because then you are then you can throw in some, especially if you go out of San Antonio, you can throw in maybe a country song or two, maybe a Josh Turner song. Everybody loves Josh Turner, or Jason Aldean or something like that. 1994 is a perfect song for baseball, softball. So it's completely different playlists, and depending on where you're at.
That's true, because I announced at Texas A&M, I've done 8 events there this year, and I have 5 more to go before the year's over with them. And Michelle Aggie, she's like, oh, well, what's your playlist? I'm like, well, I've got this. She's like, no, let me make it for you. And it's pretty much 90% country. And I'm going, well, do you want it? She's like, honey, it's A&M. They're all country people over there.
Uh-huh.
She goes, so if you play country, they'll like it. But if you start playing, you know, something else, it'll be like, oh, he must not be from here.
Yeah.
You know, so I'm like, all right. So, and I had to learn how to say howdy correctly.
Yeah.
Because howdy is not howdy at A&M. It's howday, you know. So,
it's different.
It's different where you go, and obviously you travel as well. But it's one of those things, folks, if you want to know about what an announcer does, email Jay, go to sasports.com, because, or you email me, but this is Jay for Jay, so go to sasports.com, because an announcer is not a DJ. There's two different worlds of a DJ or announcer. I've been to races where I don't take a PA, I don't take nothing, and I just walk up, grab a microphone, and they're like, oh, hey, DJ, and I'm like, I don't even know where the music they're playing. I don't even know where that stuff is. I don't even know where the stuff is. And then there's obviously you do weddings and stuff as well, because that's a whole different thing of what you can play and what you can't play.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, because then, you know, I mean, hey, if the bride and groom want to play suggestive music, you
they
know,
play,
that's,
yeah,
they play suggestive
I'm
music.
I'm sorry, Grandma.
Yeah.
But that's what she wanted to play.
Yeah. Oh, no. One time I was doing a quinceañera for a girl that was about to go to Antonian. Well, here's the problem. Dr. Sines over Antonian, he's a very stickler.
Yes.
Well, this wasn't even his event, but he was invited to the event because of the fact that I guess most of the family had gone to Antonian. And the mom was the one that had given me the playlist. And there, you know, and even the edited versions, again, just because it says it's a radio edit does not mean it's necessarily edited.
So true.
The content can still be, you know, definitely misconstrued. And so anyway, no, he actually came over to me. He says, I want this stuff turned off right now. I'm like, it's not even his event.
Right.
But you know, I mean, and I didn't feel comfortable playing it anyway, because you know what? I'm
right.
not that kind
right.
of guy. You know, and so what I do now is I have to choose my events, because I, you know, if they're going to have me play something, there might be somebody else that might be better suited.
Right.
to
right.
that event.
Right.
Because I don't feel comfortable, you know, in my own spiritual self playing.
Yeah,
lot
I did.
Of that stuff.
I did a Fiesta event, and the DJ there, I don't know where he came from, because he must have come from the underground of LA or something, because he was playing some songs, like you said, dropping F-bombs this, F-bombs that, and I'm going, okay, there's kids here. I mean, I told the director, I'm like, there's kids here. He should be playing that.
Mm-hmm.
So he went to tell him, and he would not take his headphones off. Literally,
yeah.
He was like,
yeah,
I can't hear you. You know, it's like, come on, man. There's kids there.
Yeah.
Play appropriate music. But it's one of those things, like, you know, you're a Christian man. I'm a Christian man. We understand that. But there's folks out there that don't understand that. But again, SA Sports, here for you. It's not, you know, I don't make any money off of doing radio shows. Jay doesn't make any money off of doing radio shows. He's not making any money here. But we're here for the kids, because the kids are our future.
Yes, they are. And that's what, you know, like I said, I mean, yeah, that, you know, if all you have to do is, you know, you come see my bills and you know that I'm not making a lot of money.
Yeah, I did bills last night. It wasn't pretty.
Oh, but that there's a reason why we do what we do. And
yes.
it's I mean, it's so enjoyable. And sometimes, you know, when you think, God, why are you doing this? And then you'll get that email from either a parent or,
yeah.
or a kid. I did a state tournament the TAPS volleyball tournament 1 year was at Paul Taylor Fieldhouse, and Antonian was playing in the championship game against a team from Dallas. I think it was Bishop Lynch or one of those teams that's pretty dominant up there. And the libero, she was just having a rough time. I mean, they and once a volleyball team sees you having a rough time, they're going for you.
Yeah,
yeah. They're hitting
yeah.
it right towards her. She was having a rough time or whatever, and she, you know, the coach took her out, and it was funny. That might be mine.
No,
I apologize.
All right.
So anyway, coach took her out, and I was over there in the corner where I was announcing, and I told her, I said, hey, I said it'll be okay or whatever, and so anyway, they end up, you know, going on to coming back and winning the championship.
Right.
And I got this super email that I keep to this day that talks about, you know, and the parent says, you know, my daughter,
right.
you know, told me that, you know, she was just having a miserable time out there. And then she looked over at you, and when you told her everything's be okay, she says, you know what? Everything is going to be okay.
Right.
And she says it made the whole difference for her.
But that's where makes you a good announcer, because, like I said, you're a Christian man, so you understand that, and you're there for the kid, as I am. But we've also known announcers. Northeast had one, and she got let go. And the reason why is because the soccer game was going, and she was on the microphone telling them where to kick the ball. She was like, she's like, there's a girl open on the right. Kick it to the right. You know, and they're going,
wow.
And I was there at the game, and I'm going, she's not allowed to do that. You know, and then the next week I was hired by Northeast, but it was like, and then I got too busy even for Northeast. I couldn't even do all their events. I went, yeah, I can't make it. you know, can you hire that girl back? And they're like, yeah, right. Because announcers, there's things that we see that we're going, oh, you should have made that shot. Or, you know, why are you doing that? But it's one of those things, like, that's where experienced announcers like yourself come into play and go, oh, I'll just sit on my hands, you know.
What is the scariest thing that ever happened to you announcing?
I think it was Lee Soccer. A young man broke his foot. He broke his ankle. He literally went to kick the ball, went to pivot, but the pivot foot didn't go the way it was supposed to. It stayed place. His body movement went the other way, and 90 degree popped his foot.
I was at Paul Taylor Fieldhouse. A guy named Gary Myers ended up playing for Navy, played football and basketball Navy. He's one of the Myers kids. The girls had, you know, done a run at state in basketball, and he played basketball for Taft. Very talented guy. He was also, I believe he was either a quarterback or receiver for Taft football. And he had gone up for a slam dunk against Clark. The Clark guy tried to get position on him. When he realized he didn't have it, he tried to get out of the way, but he hit him right below the hip, and so it was just a catapult thing,
right,
head first, and then his body starts flopping around,
right,
and people are screaming bloody murder. And I felt sorry because the trainer at that time, it was her first year being a high school trainer, and everybody was, you know, there were people out there getting sick.
Right.
I went over there. And blood was coming out of his ear.
Right.
I thought, I might have seen somebody die on the court.
Right.
And it took a while it seemed like forever. It was probably 15 minutes for EMS to get there. That was the worst thing. Meanwhile, what I thought was amazing was his mom had come down, Miss Myers come down, and her voice, I think, calmed it, because all she did, she stayed calm the entire time. I mean, there's people crying.
Right, people freaking out, yeah.
And she's like, Gary, relax, it's going to be okay. And what happened was he had hit that part where there's a lot of seizures activities. And so when they finally got there and everything, they strapped him down, you know, all of a sudden he's ripping off the straps and everything.
Right.
And that's making people even more upset. Nobody even want to play ball after that. You
right.
know, and we went afterwards, there was like a line of people out at the emergency room of the hospital, and it turned out he was fine. He was flirting with the nurses, you know.
Right.
But it was, but he had told us, he said that he didn't remember anything, obviously. He says, but the one thing, he was having dreams that he was playing basketball, and there was a whole bunch of people piled on top of him, and he was trying to get out.
Trying to get out
of
there.
That was when he was
breaking the straps. Yeah.
I thought that was fascinating. And he never, you know, he was obviously, they have to keep you out on something like that for like 6 weeks or something like that. And he ended up playing in the playoffs. But that was, I mean, it was really, really scary.
Right.
I mean, you, from time to time, I'll do, but especially on basketball games, you have an ACL tear. And that's always horrible because a girl, and this happens a lot with the girls. She'll go down, and you know that scream.
Right.
That scream happens, you know it's a meniscus or an ACL or something. Nothing worse than that. And you can't play music to cover it up.
Right.
That's the other thing, because, you know, they don't want music that happens. And so, I mean, you would love to play just a little background music.
Right.
But they, you know, the trainers and everything, they need to hear completely.
Right.
So you can't. But that's every time that happens, just makes me sick to my stomach.
And that's where the coaches, the trainers, you were saying, the strength and conditioning coaches and all those guys, they know their jobs. You know, they don't get hired. Oh yeah, you know how to lift weights. Okay, you're gonna be our strength and conditioning coach, because that's not what they're there for. They're there to make sure the kids are doing it properly, doing it right. And then when they get hurt like that, they know exactly what to do.
Yeah.
You know, they're like, okay, we understand. We got to keep you, you know, immobilized. We got to keep you moving. But the kids are like, oh no, we got to move. We got to do. No. Just calm down.
Yeah.
You know, and that's where, like you said, veteran announcers, officials, all those guys. You know, they really take care of the kids.
And there's so many really good trainers at these different schools, and they never get their credit. Not only that, but the student trainers. You know, they have great training programs for these students, and these students usually end up being in, you know, going into physical therapy and stuff like that. And this is a perfect training ground for that, especially football, because, you know, football, the injuries are pretty harsh a lot of times. But, you know, it was neat, because I know a lot of those people that are now high school trainers themselves, And that's kind of neat to see them, you know, make that transition. So
it's amazing. I was talking to Roosevelt's trainer the other day. We were on campus walking around and everything and taking photos for the Twitter. If you want to follow Roosevelt's Twitter, it's I Love Roosevelt. Uh-huh. But and Churchill's is I Love My Chargers. Uh-huh. But we were walking around, everything. The trainer was there. The football team, well, not the whole thing, but, you know, the guys were in there working out. And I go, oh, so who's in there? Is that JV, varsity, whatever? She goes, that's pretty much the leadership. She goes, those are the guys that were here last year, saw what happened last year, and they've got freshmen or, you know, guys are going to be on varsity this year in there because they're focused.
Right.
She goes, I've been here for 6 years. I've never seen them so focused than this year. She goes, usually when I get to school or I'm getting here and I open up everything, it takes about an hour for someone to come in. Now I'm coming here, there's kids waiting to get into the weight room.
Wow, so. That's nice to see. That's nice to see it. You know, like I was telling you about, you know, 77 kids out of Memorial playing. Yeah. It's just great to see that. You know, now what keeps that happening is the parents. I will tell you last night that the parent turnout. Granted, it's midnight on a Monday morning. Right. People have to work.
Right. Right.
You know, and you know, hopefully people show up at those games and support the kids, because I don't think they realize how important that is to the kids. I mean, the kids look up, their parents and friends and stuff are in the stands. I mean, that's so motivating. And when they're not there, it's just not the same.
I think it's like a demoralizing. I mean, I remember coming back from band and everything like that, and you look up, you're like, oh yeah, there's not that many people up there. Why are we performing? You know, but. There are a lot of folks wait. I mean, you know this, but being an announcer and stuff, but a lot of folks wait to the playoffs because you're like, oh, it means something. It means something. But to get to the playoffs, every game means something.
Yeah.
No matter what it is.
Well, Northside, you know, you got, you know, 9 teams in the district, actually 10 with Brennan, and that'll be interesting how that happens next year, because Brennan's not going to be 4A next year.
No.
Brennan will be 5A. They've got 9 teams in that district now. It's tough enough to schedule. When they have 10 teams, that means they're going to have one non-district game. Yes, because that means they'll have to play 9 other teams. So they have one non-district game. Everything else is district play.
Well, I was going to say, Clark Churchill is going to be a given. They'll always be played. However, we used to say that about Texas A&M.
We used to say that about Fox Tech and Lanier.
Oh, yeah.
Fox, you know, until they, while they didn't close down Fox Tech, it's just been, it's now, you know, more of a medical type school.
Right.
And they still do play sport. They don't play football anymore, but they play volleyball. Basketball, and some sports, but they're definitely not, you know, what they were.
Right, right.
YWLA now, you know, that's a young women leadership academy. They're playing volleyball and basketball and stuff like that. So it's, you know, they're the Cardinals. So I mean, it's you know, if you get a chance to go out and see, you want to see a team that's right. You know, fairly new, that YWLA would be a great team to see. You know, they play over Jefferson. All the SAISD schools this year are playing at their home schools because of the fact that Alamo is still torn down.
Right.
It'd be interesting to see how, you know, that works out when they get into basketball. Because somebody said it might be ready for basketball, the Alamo. But I look over there and I say, I don't think so.
Wow. Because last time I drove through there, I mean, the parking lot, there wasn't any parking lot. Yeah. It was just ripped up and there's construction stuff all over.
I don't think it's going to be ready for, you know, I mean, you know, it'll be the first time that anything with, you know, that has to do with school construction actually got done on time. Yeah, because it's usually always over budget and, you know.
Right.
So it'll be interesting. You say you do some stuff over at Roosevelt. Boy, I tell you what, compared to 10 years ago, that school sure does look pretty nice.
It's
they have one of the nicer gyms.
Oh, it's incredible.
But that entire campus just has been transformed, and I love it.
Yeah, it's gorgeous. They're starting to get a lot of school pride. They got a new principal over there last year, not this year, Melvin Eckerd. Incredible young man. And I say young because he's younger than I am, but he, you know, he's been there, done that kind of thing. I mean, to be a principal in Northeast or Northside, definitely have been there, done that kind of folks. But they've got new leadership over there, new APs. I mean, Lori Murak, one of the assistant principals at Roosevelt, was actually the math guru of Northeast.
Uh-huh.
She worked at central office. She was the math person. She goes, you know, I want to be a principal one day.
Right.
And they say, okay, well, you got to be an assistant principal, and then you go be a principal at middle school, and then we'll make you a principal at high school. And she's like, okay, I'll do that.
Yeah.
So, you know, she's over at Roosevelt. Nice. Michelle, obviously, my wife, is over at Roosevelt, lead counselor. She was at church. She was at John Jay, another great program. But she was at John Jay for 8 years, went to Churchill for 9 years. The week before she was going back on contract last year, they called her and said, oh, we need you at Roosevelt. We have new leadership. We need you over there. And she goes, oh, I'm leaving Churchill? And, you know, me being a Churchill grad, I'm going, well, no, whoa, wait, you know. But Roosevelt, great, great kids. They're all very respectful over there and everything. Football program, incredible. They had we talk about cheerleaders real quick. I got a real quick story for you. The tryouts were already done, and you know how the tryouts program worked.
Right.
Cheerleading is huge in Texas, almost as big as football, if not bigger. Because, like you said, a lot of cheerleaders go on to cheering for USC or, you know, Stanford or any of these big powerhouse schools. And there was a young man that transferred in afterwards. He moved in from Virginia, I think. Mm-hmm. And the tryouts were already done. And the coach is like, sorry, my hands are tied. You know, you can't do anything. And he literally went from one side of the quad. You talk about the beautiful facility. And just backflip, no hand backflip, backflip, the way across the quad. Did a double handspring, tummy tuck twist, or what they call it, landed on his feet, and they're going, you know, everybody's just going crazy. The principal's going crazy and everything. Uh-huh. And she's like, there's nothing I can do.
Wow.
I mean, obviously the ultimate cheerleader, and there's nothing you can do.
Yeah. And that is a shame because, I mean, you know, it, you know, sometimes, you know, you do have to, I think, you know, that they there should be, you know, because there's people, this is Military City USA still.
Huge.
There's always people moving into San Antonio, you know.
Especially in the summer because, you know, that's when the military do the moves because of the schools.
And I just can't understand why they can't let, you know, people, you know, right, get into something, you know, but. You know, like I said, you know, people have rules and we have to follow them.
We have to follow the rules. We have to follow the rules. But folks, again, sasports.com. Go to the website. You can find it on Facebook, SA Sports. You can find it on Twitter. Do you still do your Twitter?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. All right, SA Sports. Yeah, we got about 600 followers. But especially now that the football season's, you know, huge, getting a little closer. Because our Friday night football scoreboard is the best in the city. I mean, we update the scores every 2 to 3 minutes. We have like a team of 10 people that. Yeah. That are doing this with all the schools around. So, and it's all on one page. So, you know, it's like nothing against Express News. But you know, if you try nice. To get scores on there, you're going to be flipping around for forever. And
yeah, because now you're not only following SA schools or like you're like, oh, we're only doing Northside, we're only doing Northeast.
Houston schools and all that stuff.
You got Houston, you got Floresville.
It's a mess. Yeah. So anyway, I mean, we got all the San Antonio and surrounding area high schools, but it's all on one page.
Right.
And it doesn't have any Java or anything else that's going to slow you down. So, I mean, you just click on there. And our text number is 210-419-1212. And that's how everybody texts us during the year for, you know, score updates and stuff at the football games.
That's nice. So folks, obviously get a hold of Jay Tope at sasports.com. You're gonna see him on TV and going, hey, I remember that guy, and he's always around. He's not going anywhere.
Yeah. I'm like a cockroach. Can't kill me.
Can't kill him, that's right. Jay Tope, sasports.com. Go to the website, go to the Facebook page, like the Facebook page. Obviously, like I said, go to the Twitter, follow it. Friday nights after the games, everything's uploaded. You see the screens, you see the scores and all that fun stuff. And we appreciate you, obviously, for watching the Ustream. And this is taped. It is live, but it's also taped. So you can go back through and listen to it. If you know, you're like, oh, I'm cooking. What did they just say about that? You know, what was the hints for who's going to be on the cover in September? But so many good things coming up. And we're going to, obviously, you come back on whenever you want. We can do whatever you want to do. Cool. and put the word out. And you can bring guests back if you want to or not. I have no problem with that.
Appreciate you taking your time out have me on.
We've got a great green room. We got a flat screen. We got a fridge. We got a bathroom. We're good. But no, folks, thanks for listening. Thanks for watching. If you have any questions, you can email Jay. Where how do they get a hold of you, Jay?
You can get, again, the phone number is 210-419-1212 or just my name, JAYTOPE, Jay Tope at sasports.com or friend me on Facebook.
There you go. Jay Tope. It's not that hard to spell his name, T-O-P-E. But again, God bless everybody. Take care. It's Monday. Hydrate. Stay hydrated. And take care of yourself and your families. And we'll see you soon.